Right. So what we're going to do is continue where we left off last week. So I'm just going to recap what we went over. So we'll be covering two subjects today. One is hashing, and the last one is digital certificates. So at the end of it, I'll give you a heads up on how you should study, because we've covered a lot of material, but really there's things that you need to concentrate on for the test. So I'll go over the study guide, how you study, and so on. But before that, we'll cover the last two subjects that we need to. Okay, and we outlined that what we really need is to get a thumbprint, a fingerprint of data. And it could be for a person, it could be for a file, or it could be for data in general. So we'll see that the MD5 hash signature is one method that we actually use. So there's MD5 there. So we either represent it in a, it's always a fixed length, no matter how much data that we actually have. And for MD5, we have 128-bit signature. For Base64, we have 128 divided by 6. And you can count the characters that we have there. Why is there no equals at the end of that hash signature? It's multiple of 4. So we've got multiples of 4 characters. If it doesn't fit, then we either put equals in or we pad. So you find that there's no equals in a hash, an MD5 hash signature. Okay, and then we have bigger ones. So unfortunately, MD5 has been seen, as we'll see, has collisions and can't be trusted anymore. SHA-1 is in the same category. It's theoretically possible for a collision. A collision occurs when you take different data and you create the same hash signature. And that can cause problems with the verification of identity. So it is possible, but many people in the industry are really worried that it's going to happen sometime soon, that any digital certificate that is signed with SHA-1 could be faked. So one way for an intruder to get a backdoor into a machine, and it happened with a hack in the Far East, in a hotel in the Far East, that people who visited the hotel were targeted with Adobe updates that were actually signed by a fake certificate, which meant that backdoors could be put into the Adobe products. And it was to do with the weak certificates that were actually used. They were using, I think, 512-bit encryption keys, which were fairly easy to hack. Okay, and what happens is that we just change one bit of data and it completely changes the hash signature there. In the lab today, what we'll do is we'll look at how we can implement this with OpenSSL, and we'll use Hashcat and John the Ripper to be able to reverse our passwords that shouldn't really be reversible. But as you should all know by now, the things like rainbow tables and brute force, it's not too difficult to actually determine the hash of it. Okay, so we often use our hash in terms of hashing files, and increasingly we're hashing to be able to prove the identity of services and things like that. Okay, so we've got our thumbprint on a digital certificate. We'll look in more detail at that today. But the thumbprint tells us that the whole of the entity can be trusted. If we end up with a different thumbprint when we create the hash of it, then we know that there's actually something wrong there. Okay, and we see it all over the place. So in Windows, we've got two types of passwords. So we have our NT passwords, which is stored in the Windows Hive, and at one time it was an MD4 hash, and it produced a fairly weak hash signature. So we have LM and an NT2 hash. None of them are encrypted. They are pure hashes, and as we'll see in the lab today, it's not too difficult to break those hashes. We also see it in Cisco devices. So here is a hashed password here. And the problem that we have two problems here, is that for one, the method is exposed. So we'll see here the one defines that it's MD5. Not a very good hash already. And the second is that the salt is also contained within the second field. So when we look at hashes, we'll find the dollar signs delimit the type typically and the salt. So as we looked at in encryption, we need salt to make sure that we change. And in hashing, we definitely need salt from there. And there's the hash part at the end. So you can see here, if this was a real device, then really that's not a very good method of storing a password, because MD5s really aren't a very good hashing method. Okay, so if you maintain Cisco routers, just make sure that the hash that's there is robust enough. Okay, so the way that they're cracked is to create either a dictionary attack, where we can create each of the hashes, or we create a rainbow table. So the rainbow table is a pre-prepared list of hashes, and the intruder just goes back and is able to reverse the original password from there. And as outlined, the problem that we have is that sometimes companies don't salt their passwords. So it happened in the Adobe hack when 150 million accounts were the usernames and passwords were breached, and it was found that nearly 2 million people selected the password of 123456, closely followed by 123456789, password Adobe 123. So when you're given the user the opportunity to take six characters or more, then the majority of them in virtually all of the password databases will select 123456. And the problem with the Adobe hack was that they hadn't salted it, which meant once somebody had cracked this hash, they had cracked 2 million hashes at the same time. When we salt the same password will come out as a different hash each time. You can see here that even 113,000 people selected 111111. So you can't trust your users to be selecting good passwords, really. And if they're selecting these passwords, then a dictionary attack, even if you've salted, even if you're using, as we'll find out, bcrypt or a top quality hashing method, they're still going to be cracked because they're fairly easy to crack. So these will be the top 10 passwords that a cracker would try first to see if they worked. And even though they're using a slow method of hashing, then they can still be broken. And what can happen is there's a jump off. So they will generally jump through the accounts. So if someone uses the same password for each of the accounts, they can jump onto each of them. So if you looked at the IBM Pond site, Troy Hunt maintains a database of all the hacked passwords. So you can actually have a look for your own email address to see if you've included in that. Mm-hmm. So certainly there's been a couple of LinkedIn hacks recently. There was a Yahoo a hack just a few weeks ago, and it was quite unfortunate because Yahoo had implemented what's called bcrypt, which is a really good hashing method, but you've got to read all the way down the article until you get to the bottom and say they'd use bcrypt, but they got such bad press from it. And it's often forgotten about some of the methods around salting and the methods that are actually used. So make sure when your company reports a breach, and it's going to become more and more important that you articulate to your CEO what the scope of the breach is, what you've done well, what's been good about it. Because with GDPR coming along, companies will have to report within a couple of days. And if you report badly, it can kill your company. If you report well, you actually find there's a positive thing. Your share price can go up because it looks like you're managing things very well. Okay, so incident response is going to become a big area for many companies, and the ability to respond to a hack and clean it up and report on it will be extremely important. Otherwise, you'll get fined 4% of your global turnover, which is a fair fine. Okay, so we looked at this last week in the number of passwords that we have. So 7 digits, A to Z, gives us 256 to the power of 7. And that should be big Z there. We have 52 to the power of 7. And then here we have 52, we'll say plus 10. So that's 62 to the power of 7. We then take the cracking rate. So this is 100 billion, which is times 10 to the 9. Times 10 to the 9. So we'd represent that on the calculator like that, 100 e to the 9. So we basically take that number and we divide it by the cracking rate. And that gives us an idea of how strong our passwords are. So I'll just demo again what we looked at last week. Let's see if we can find it, password strength. Okay, so we have different character sets. In a regular expression, you have the square brackets, A to Z. Most times you're forced to go for a character, which in the first position, which already weakens the password. Most people put the number at the end. Is that true? When you're asked for a number, do you put it at the end? And is it 1?
No, it's not 1.
Is it 9?
It's
not at the end.
It's at the end.
It's at the end.
It is at the end, but it's not 1.
Yeah. Does anybody use the S goes into 5? Does anybody use that one? Use that one? And an O goes into 0. Any other ones that you've got that you want to? Yeah. Wait, what have you got?
I goes into 1.
Okay. Anything else? Want to admit to changing any of the letters? A dollar? A what?
E goes
3. Yeah. That works. Yeah. So E goes to 3. Unfortunately, the hackers know that one. So they've already got that. All those pre-prepped. Anything that's been into Google is basically hashed. I found Jim Carrey with Spacey's movie star has been hashed. So every single time something goes into Google, there's a hash of it, and it'll appear in a database somewhere. Okay, so there's our cracking. So what we'll do is we'll go for a billion. It's not that fast, as we'll see here. But this gives us 2 to the power of 26. It should give us this number here. We're now taking only one processing element. That's just your PC. And we can then calculate. Okay, so with nine digits here, it's taking you an hour and a half for A to Z. I think between about 8 and 10 is what most online systems are focusing on. Certainly my ISP forces me to go for between 8 and 10, which is a difficulty because my password is about 12. So I've got to remember every single time I log on that it isn't that password that I chop. You got the same problem?
Yeah.
You're a bit
bored. I use special characters in mine, and some people don't have special characters.
They don't. My ISP tells me that QWERTY 11 is a good password and gives me a little green. and I've tweeted them so many times, and I've emailed them, and I've posted on LinkedIn. I can show you the history of it, and still it's between 8 and 10, and QWERTY11 is a good password. One thing I do know is that QWERTY11 isn't a good password at all. Okay, so there we are. So already we've moved from about a day and a half to 32 days just by making sure it's upper and lowercase. So this is every single password. If we now add numbers on there, we're up to 156 days, which is looking a bit better. And now we'll force the user to at least put in one little character in there. So straight away, we're up to 2 years to hash the whole, every single password on the whole of the database. Okay, so, but then if we go for an NVIDIA graphics card with 4,000 a GPU that you can either get in the Amazon cloud or in your PlayStation, your Xbox, we're back down to 4.5 hours for a 9-digit password. And then if we go for a really fast cracker, then 27 minutes cracks every single nine digit. And once they're cracked. So the database has been created with every single permutation. If we move to 10, you're still looking at just over a day to crack every single password. So the moral of the story is, don't ever hash passwords without salt. Okay, if you're asking for trouble, and this is the trouble that you get, so even up here, there's a very good chance that even with 11 digits, then it can be cracked. Okay, so that's what we have. So the main methods that are around, so there are many of them. That you come across, lmhash and nt2. Nt2 hash are the Windows methods. John the Ripper will know what looks like a Windows hash and what looks like an Apache log hash. So it can sense each of the different hashing methods, and then it'll kick in whatever one's in there. So lmhash is there. You'll see the RIP-EMD is used in TrueCrypt. TrueCrypt doesn't really exist anymore, kinda. It had to leave the US to go somewhere else. The open source developers decided that they just didn't want to do it anymore, and they stopped the open source version of TrueCrypt, which is the only real competitor against Microsoft in terms of disk encryption. But luckily the source code is now maintained outside the US. I think there's one in Switzerland that's actually maintained from it. And that's always a worry with any open source. How good are the people maintaining it? Are they just a couple of guys maintaining the code? It happened with OpenSSL. Really, it wasn't proper development, and we've paid for it ever since. There's Tiger. SHA-3 is a new crypto method that they worry that SHA-1 and SHA-2 will be cracked. So they've came up with a new one called SHA-3. So SHA-3 should be quantum robust, and also it should be uncrackable for a good amount of time. Bcrypt is an amazing method, and I highly recommend it. Bcrypt is about as slow a method as you can get, and it does about 150 hashes a second. It's so slow. And you can even slow it more. It has rounds. It has many rounds, so you keep hashing. If you give it about 20 rounds, it'll take a few seconds to hash for you. So if you can, make sure in your company you're using something like Bcrypt, because Bcrypt will make it much more difficult for somebody to actually reverse the hash. Okay, so those are some of the contenders in there. So here's an example here. So along with Bcrypt, every time you connect to Wi-Fi, you're actually using PBKDF2. Along with bcrypt, this guy is about as slow as you can get. So in the hashing world, you'll be lucky if you get a few hundred hashes per second out of PBKDFS2. And because in WPA and Wi-Fi, you typically at home will use a pre-shared key, the last thing that you want is for somebody to hack that pre-shared key, because it will compromise the whole of the network. So the password is protected through PBKDF2. I hope you remember that one. So it's short for password-based key derivation function, and the boring standard is RFC 2898. And it uses SALT and a password initially to be able to create the hashing function. It's used in TrueCrypt, where that's actually used to create a key. The key then protects the header, which actually has the proper encryption with the AES, 2FISH and 3DES. So the keys that are there for your disk, what's encrypted, are actually in that little header. So, yeah.
Actually, TrueCrypt was recently in news, saying that it is discontinued and it's not safe. Do you know what's going on with that?
Oh yeah, so that's what I was mentioning a little bit back there. So it's now in a Swiss open repository. So the US developers stopped maintaining it.
Yeah.
And because of open source licenses, you're not allowed to take it away from the current repository. But some people around the world have cloned it outside the US. So I think it is still running.
Are those the guys from Veracrypt?
From where?
Veracrypt.
Crypt. In Switzerland.
Yeah, I think.
Yeah. I'll check in between. It's the only show in town that has a part of the market that BitLocker virtually has all of it, but obviously that's a proprietary brand. It's a corporate thing. You actually find that your encryption keys are stored on the Active Directory server. So if somebody really wants to get into your disk and they're an insider in the company, they can actually get the encryption keys there. So it is made for a corporate type environment where this is very much aimed at open source in there. Okay, so this one, you've got passwords, you've got salting, and you create it. So this is the method that we use here for Wi-Fi. You see there's an SSID and a passphrase. For WPA, a pre-shared key, that's the passphrase that goes in to it. So if we were using conventional methods, then that might cause problems for us. So just let me try and find hashing methods. Let's see. And I think I've got a single Python script that outlines all the methods. Okay, so this page here shows all the different types that you can get for your hashing methods. Just let me expand to that there. See if I can make it a bit smaller. Okay, so that's what the hashing looks like. So for the Windows hashes here, we can see there isn't any dollars or anything like that. It's just a pure hash. There's no salt involved. If we look at bcrypt, there's bcrypt there. So the 2A defines that we're using bcrypt. The 0.5 is the number of rounds. 5 is acceptable without crunching my server. If I put something like 15 in there, 15 rounds, it would still probably be calculating the hash function. So the 0.5 is the number of rounds it does. Then we've got the salt after that, and the hash. And on a Linux system, we have APR is the method used, APR1. The next part is then the salt that we're going to use, and then the part after that is the hash. Okay, so something that isn't salted will look a bit like this. So there's the SHA-1 for that, and you can see there isn't any hashes on there. There's the PBK DFS2 method. Yeah. Okay, so again, you're seeing the number of rounds in there and here. Okay, so that's got to be there because it'll tell whoever is doing the hashing that it needs to go around five times from there. Okay, so that's the code that we'll do this. So we'll use Paslib in the lab for a little Python script. So you can see it's doing Cisco passwords here, and a number of other ones. Okay, so the ones you'll see quite often is this PBKDFF2, which is used in WPA in our Wi-Fi systems. Okay, so let's look at salting. So as we've seen, salting is required because it is possible for somebody to use a rainbow table or a dictionary attack against it. All salting will do is to try and make it just a bit more difficult for the intruder so that they will not have a rainbow table set up already, but it doesn't stop them. You need to store the salt with the hash, so there's nothing you can do. If you lose the salt, you're kind of stuffed in terms of logging in. So the salt needs to be held beside the hash method. There are methods that allow you to keep the salt somewhere else, and it may be possible that within the user's account, more and more companies are getting forced to allow users to be able to control their own identity. So you might actually find the salt is on their device, and the only way that you can actually access their ID and their details is to take the salt and what we call the nonce from the machine. The user gives it away, and then rather than storing the salt on the server, it's stored on the device. So this shows an example of an MD5 salted password. It's MD5 because that says 1 in there. We can have APR1, and as we've seen, we can have all the different methods there. The next part is the salt. So with salt, we take the password, and then we append it with the word there, the salt. How would the salt length? How would the salt length vary the strength of the hash that we have? Does it matter how many characters we have in the salt? Do you think?
If it's increasing the effective length of the password, it must be.
Because
it's making the password longer.
No, it doesn't make the hash longer.
It
makes the password longer. Yeah. The more difficult it will be for the intruder to be able to search through all the different salts. So yeah, you're right. So the longer that we have for our salt, the more difficult it will be. But you'll see in the lab, if we use QWERTY 1.1, even with salt, then John the Ripper cracks it in an instance. It doesn't have any problem because it can lift the salt off there. Okay, so we have our hash of it, which is in there, and this is how we do it in OpenSSL. We define the method here and define that it's got salt, and then it should salt for us. Okay, so to be able to create our, when the user logs in, they will log in with their password. So in this case, the password is Red Hat. So what needs to happen is that the system will take the salt and will take the user's password and then will rehash. And if the hash is equal to the part in here, difficult to see it, but after they set the last dollar, then the user has the right password. Okay, so in this way, you can check the password, because it's not possible for the system to be able to reverse the password from there. And so the problem that we have with hashing methods is that we can get what's called a collision. So a collision happens when two different data inputs create the same hash signature. So the collision can happen where we have different data streams giving us the same password. So just let me show you the one for MD4 that was discovered. So MD4. Okay, and it was discovered that the data input with these two different streams actually gives the same hash, the same MD4. Output from there. Just let me try it here. Okay, so when you input the streams, then there's just a change between here and here, and if you see between here and here, they will produce the exact same MD4 signature. So collisions are worrying, but obviously if it's... What's mostly worrying is that if you get a message that has full context, so full context might be that I say hello, and I can change the message to make it goodbye. It's still got a context, so it still means something, and I can create the same hash for that. And so this was just back in 2006. It was 18 hours for a SHA-1 collision. So this is one of the first that was discovered. So this is MD5. So you can see there are just a few places, because of the scrambling algorithm that they use within MD5, the bits don't mangle themselves enough. So if you just change those two values in red, the values in red, then you actually get the exact same hash signature. Okay, so that might not seem that significant, but then this guy here decided to play with some images, and he took James Brown and Barry White, and he started stuffing bytes into the images. Images has got lots of places that you can put bytes that don't actually get viewed. So he just kept putting in bytes, and eventually he came up with the exact same hash signature for both images. He's since done it with three images. In this case, it cost them 60 cents to do that with the with an NVIDIA card on the Amazon cloud. And the math behind it is that you have a high probability of actually getting a collision eventually if you randomly sample. So it's to do with the birthday attack. And the birthday attack says that I think for 19 people in a class, there will be at least two people with the same birthday. It's a 50%, so we've got 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12, 14, 16, 18, 20, 22. So I reckon the odds in my favour of finding a birthday is probably about 85% moving towards 90%. So we'll give it a little try. So January. Nobody was born in January. What's your birthday? 24 now. February? Okay.
22nd.
What is it?
Second.
8th. Anything else? March? 19th?
13th.
Well, 13th. 31st. 6th, sorry. April?
23rd.
4th.
Oh. May? Get worried. June?
17th.
Well, it doesn't matter, you know what I mean? Not bothered about you. Nobody else in June? Come on. No? July?
4th.
7th. 2nd. August?
12th.
8th. Yeah. September? On your own? Go and tell us. Okay, October? 21st. What was that, 21st and 28th?
Yeah.
Oh, dull. November? 2nd. Anyone else? And December, please?
1st. 21st.
Oh, I do. Okay, well, it was lucky I didn't bet then. The mass behind it, and hopefully I can find it here. The mass. I try and find my birthday attack. So in a room, I think, of 20 people, if we take an example here, about 28, actually I had a 65% chance. So it wasn't great, just a bit over half. With 60 people in a room and doing a pub, you probably get thrown out, but doing a pub of 60 people, you go, oh, no, the professor told me, get it. I can assure you, if you want to put a bet on it in a pub, find 60 people, and you have a 99.412% chance that at least two people will have the same birthday from there. So it's just unfortunate that didn't work. But that was the method that Hugh used to be able to get the same hash signature. And in the lab today, we'll take an EXE and we'll actually modify it with a good EXE and a bad EXE. And there's a program on the internet that allows us to be able to modify each of the EXEs by stuffing and end up with the same hash, which is a bit worrying because you get told when you download a program to check the hash off it, and somebody can actually modify that to create the same hash. So that's obviously a worry for us. Okay, so that's what Nat did, and he did it with Hashcat. We'll be using Hashcat today. Hashcat runs on the CUDA architecture, so it's compiled specially to run on your NVIDIA. So it doesn't run per se. The version that he used doesn't run on your normal sort of PC, it runs on CUDA. Okay, the other hashing method that we see is LM and NTLM hashes. So in a Windows domain infrastructure, You'll find that each machine has this ID. This is your user name at the end here. The admin is 500 and the guest is 501. And the first users start around here. And the other bits are the domain names. The passwords, and it's quite lucky, if you boot your disk into a rescue mode and you've lost your the Windows registry, or if you've lost passwords, then they're actually stored in a file and will be unprotected. So it's a standard way that someone would get the passwords off a machine, is to take the disk out of the machine, put it to another machine, and then there's no lock on the files anymore, and then they'll go into the System 32 folder with the subfolder, and they'll actually find the Hive that stores the usernames and passwords. So it's just as a file on the system. So an intruder would typically go here, take the passwords off, and then use John the Ripper to be able to reverse the passwords. Okay, so that's where they're stored within the Windows Hive. And when you're looking for them, they're there. And it's quite wonderful when you've mucked up your machine to be able to go in here and actually find your SAM. And I advise you strongly to make a copy of them. So boot your machine up into a safe mode, get them off into a USB stick, because if you corrupt your registry, then it can cause real problems. So the actual SAM database is held in that folder here, and an intruder will just basically take that SAM file and get it off the machine, and then use John the Ripper to be able to take the hashes off. So these are an example of the two types of hashes. So they upgraded the hash from LM hash onto NTLM. It's still not a great hash from there. Okay, so there's an example of our Windows password listing. And here we're using John the Ripper to be able to crack the passwords, and you can see it's managed to crack that one there. The other one that we use is Offcrack. So Offcrack is a more of a user, it has a GUI with it, and we can preload our rainbow table in there. We can see here that it's also managed to crack that there from the LM hash. Okay, and then these days it's big business to be able to crack hashes. So either you're law enforcement and you need to be able to crack passwords and so on, or if you're on a Bitcoin network, then you're given, the miners are giving a workload. Does anybody know what the workload of a miner is on a Bitcoin network? What is the puzzle that they must solve? Yeah, but it's not just So they need to take the old ledger and the new ledger, all the transactions that have happened in the last 10 minutes. So they need to take all of that and the new ones and create a new hash. Does anybody know what the hash will look like? So just to do a SHA-256 wouldn't be enough. That would be quite easy. What's the challenge? See if I can find an example. So the challenge is to come up with a hash which starts with zeros. Can't find it there. Blockchain work. So the challenge is to come up with a hash which will have a certain number of zeros. If you've ever looked at a blockchain, you'll see that each one, when they create a new blockchain hash, it will have a whole lot of zeros at the start. So the miners have got to take the whole of the hash, all of the transactions, and compute a new hash by adding values onto it until there is a certain number of zeros at the start. So you can see my first hash for hello here. All I'm doing it with this one is to come up with a hash that starts with zero. So you can see I've hashed, keep hashing, keep going round, adding a number on until I get to 28 in this case, and appears with a zero there. Okay, so have a look at the current blockchain, and you'll actually see at the end of each blockchain that's created every 10 minutes is a hash that begins with a whole lot of zeros. And the first Bitcoin miner which can find the new hash which works wins and gets rewarded. Does anyone know what the reward is?
Is it Bitcoin?
How many?
One.
One. The it's less now, so it used to be, but now you don't get as much of a reward. Every so often they reduce just to make sure the supply, there isn't an oversupply. So that's where we have that. So we get these massive computers which are really just parallel processing devices. This one here does 1.5 tera hashes. Tera is what? 10 to the power of?
No.
That's giga. What? 12. So it does 1.5 tera. It costs $3,000 to $5,000 there. And there's a GPU one there. It will crack every NTLM password within 5.5 hours, and a 14 character LM hash in six minutes. 350 hashes per second. And then we have signed hashes. So sometimes what we want to do is to be able to be sure that we have a hash which has been signed by a secret key or by a private key. So in this case we use HMAC. So HMAC, we use all the normal hashing methods, but this time what we do is we encrypt the hash. So on the other end, we can be sure that the other side has signed it because it has the secret key, and it might be the private key, or it could be a key that we negotiated at the start of the conversation. So HMAC is there to validate that the hash that was created really was created by the entity which is sending it. And passwords are kind of rubbish. I mean, really, we need to move away from passwords as the single method of authenticating somebody. They're getting longer. We've got to try and remember it. We've got fingers, we've got retinas, we've got faces. It's just a crazy way that we have one factor of authentication.
Didn't the Chinese government post something 2 weeks ago saying about how people should stop their messy photos because
that's it? That's exactly it. There's some research that you can actually monitor your baby's heart rate through Wi-Fi. Next door, so you can actually monitor even the how the skin breathes. They reckon with the high resolution cameras on the PlayStation, you can actually monitor somebody's respiratory rate, because the camera can actually see your skin going up and down. So you're completely clipped. Face recognition really struggles to be credible. But it's going to be used as multi-factor. So just every so often you ask for somebody's face and it just gives a new way. So we'll come on to that later, okay? We've done a lot of work in this area. But we really need to move away from the concept of just hashing it. What we need is a nonce, a seed, a starting point, and then we iterate from that. So you find a lot of people have these RSA keys. You'll see they look at their RSA key and they'll have the password that that's required at that given time. If you use a Google authenticator, then you'll get a token every time you log in, and that's your new one. And so that's the basis of one-time passwords and timed passwords. So a one-time password is that what we do is we hash each time. So as long as the original person doesn't know what the original seed was, we will just keep going and hashing it each time. So the next password will be the next hash and so on. And it's impossible for somebody to trace back if they don't know what the nonce was. You make sure when you create the nonce that the person is there, you see them, and you physically say that you are now registered, that's it. And then where you keep the nonce is obviously important, and more it might be that you keep it on your mobile phone, and then if somebody wants access to your password and so on, they would have to get access to your phone to be able to work out what the next hash was. Then we also get a timed password. So with a timed password, the password only exists for a certain amount of time, and you can put some sort of limit on that. And then we can have a counter one. So I'll just give you a demo of a timed password. Okay, so this is a one-time password. Okay, so each time then I generate, based on this seed, the next one will be based on the previous one and so on. So I can generate a new seed, okay, and then we'll iterate from there. So every time you logged in, you would have a new password, and only by knowing the nonce would you actually know what the next password should be from that. So for a timed password, so in this demo, I think I've set a 5 second, 5 seconds. So I'm clicking here, I can't generate, and there's a new one generated. And that's it there, okay. So even though I'm clicking there, I can't generate a new one. So with a timed password, it's just like the RSA key. Have you seen people using that more? It's increasingly used in the industry. You have your key in your pocket or so, and you bring it up, you open it up, and then based on the time, it will give you a new key, and it's only valid for a certain amount of time. So Google Authenticator uses it. In this case, the code that I've used just has a 5 second window, but you can make it longer. If it was the password to get into a building, say, you could allow access for a day, and then after a day, it would change onto another one. Okay, so that's used increasingly, and you can also get a hashed one-time password. Okay, so we're just using a seed here, and we can work out what the hash is from there. Okay, a last couple of little things is the problem with the passwords, the hashing methods I've shown you is they're crypto methods. They are highly processor intensive. They take a lot of scrambling and so on. There are other kids there, Murmur and FNV, who are non-crypto. If you want fast rather than slow, if you need it to be fast on an IoT device, it doesn't have the computational power to do a SHA-256 on an HMAC, then these two guys here are the fastest around. One last little thing, and a method that we've used quite a lot, is what's called the Shamir share method. Shamir share method allows you to be able to break your data into shares, and then you can define a policy. So the way we implement it is any two shares from three can come together to recreate the shares. So in this way, none of the shares are hackable, at all. You can take each share and there is no knowledge. Basically, it does a mathematical function. If you have 2 points on a graph, you can work out the straight line or the gradient. If I give you 1 point and I keep 1 point, then only by bringing the 2 points together can we actually create the gradient. Without that knowledge of the other point, it's impossible to work out what the gradient is. So Shamir came up with the mathematics to go for different curves, quadratics and so on, and was able to do this. And what we managed to do with this is that we stripe data across different clouds. So we'll take a whole chunk of data and we'll put one share in one cloud, another share in another cloud, and we might keep our own share on our own network. And that means if one of our cloud systems goes down, say the middle one, we can still recreate the data back again. And an Edinburgh company has built that infrastructure at scale and at production. And I think they've got over 20 or 30 cloudlets all over the world, and the data can then be scrambled, and it's impossible to be able to get the data back from there. So that's something that we've looked at here. The other alternative to this doesn't scale because the mathematics behind taking a movie and sharing 12 shares and doing a 10 from 12 is almost impossible. So what we do is we share the key. We use AES encryption, and then we split the key up and give each of the shares of the key to different entities. Okay, so that's been a quick overview of hashing. What we'll do is to look at some biometrics and some digital certificates after the break. Okay, thanks. Right, okay, so we'll make a little start. Yeah. Right, so this is the last of the 3 weeks. So the first test will be focused on the four subjects that we've actually done, and I'll give you an overview of what's required for the test. Okay, so we need to finish it off with the most loved of all technologies on the internet, and that's digital certificates and PKI, public key infrastructure. And it's probably an area that few people really understand how it all works. So hopefully we'll be able to understand the complete process of how authentication really works on the internet. So we're looking at certificates, some PKI. Again, we'll come back to signing with a private key because it's all interwoven. And I won't cover federated ID, maybe just touch on it a little bit at the very end. Okay, so there's our main methods that we have for our encryption, symmetric encryption, asymmetric, and one-way hashing. And what we'll find in PKI is that they all really fit together perfectly. Okay, and as we said, crypto isn't just about confidentiality. It's as much about authentication and identity, and it's as much about integrity too. So crypto really fits together and allows us to identify and authenticate devices, keep things confidential, and prove that things really are what they are. So the problem that we have now is that if Bob needs to get his key over to Alice, how does he actually do it? Because obviously Eve could send the key. So what we create is an infrastructure that allows us to be able to pass the key, because we want to make sure that what we encrypt hasn't been tampered by Eve in this case. So the public key is the way that we identify Bob. So Bob will sign for something with his private key, and then we must get the public key to Bob. But what's to stop Eve saying, "I'm Bob, here's Bob's public key, you can trust me." And this is the biggest dilemma on the internet, is that who do you really trust? Who is the most trusted entities? Who do you trust to be able to pass these special public keys and who should issue them. So we now bring in the concept of Trent. Okay, so Trent is our third person. So we've got Bob and Eve, and now we've got Trent. So Trent is our trusted entity. Trent is trusted by both Bob and Alice to at least prove something, prove the identity of Bob to Alice or the identity of Alice to Bob and so on. So trust is a key factor in this. So let's look at some basic authentication methods first before we look at our certificates. So we authenticate users, devices, systems, data, and so on, all which will fit together. And the problem that we have on the internet is that we typically authenticate machine to machine. So when we identify ourselves to a server, we're actually identifying the device to the server. So the way that HTTPS works and the way that most protocols work is it's a device to device. And it doesn't really authenticate the user to the end service. And more we're moving towards this part here as the last mile in authentication, and we need to bridge that factor. If we want to know that somebody has read an email, just because it was delivered to the exchange server doesn't mean that person is going to read the email. So with the usage of things like biometrics, we can actually tell that a user has really read a message from them. So we can go for end-to-end authentication, and it might be from user to user at the other end, or we can go for intermediate authentication. On the internet, we can have one-way authentication. So with one-way authentication, with HTTPS, the server authenticates itself to us. But we can also, on a Wi-Fi network, we authenticate ourselves to a service. So that's a client authentication, with the other one as a server one. But increasingly, what we want is a mutual authentication, where the user authenticates themselves to the service and vice versa. So some of the ways that we authenticate, we can, obviously if it's a device, we can use the MAC address or the IP address, an encryption key and so on. For the user, we can use biometrics, passphrase, a soft token and so on. So the standard model that we have when we're authenticating someone, when we look at multi-factor authentication, is it something you have, something you know, something you are, and increasingly it's somewhere you are. So somewhere you are will do some sort of geolocation and actually determine where you are. And in multi-factor authentication, we want to be getting at least two or three of these different ways. It doesn't do any good to keep asking something that you know, because somebody could actually know something about you. If you keep prompting them for that information, then it's not actually going to reveal much more about the identity. Okay, so something you are is biometrics. Something you have is something like a certificate, and something you know is is a PIN number or a passphrase. And really, usability and robustness usually maps into this. If it's highly usable, you actually find that it's not a very robust method in terms of proving identity. And then the more the robustness of authentication goes up, the less easy it is to use the method. So we start from here in DHCP and MAC addresses, which really aren't very secure in terms of proven identity, right up to biometrics. Okay, so we use the names and passwords. You see the problems that we have in that a 10-character password gives us that number of passwords, but you actually find that most passwords will fit into a very small dictionary. Some research was done that's about 8,000 passwords would cover most passwords. Then we get the concept of entropy, and entropy relates to the equivalent number of bits that are equivalent to the number of passwords that are on the system. And we take log to the base 2 of that value, and that will give us the equivalent key size. You obviously don't have log to the base 2 in your calculator. You have log to the base 10. So you convert log to the base 2 by taking log to the base 10 and dividing it by log to the base 10 of 2. Okay? So you can do it later. 8192 log divided by the log of 2, and you should get the value of 13 bits. So this gives us what's called key entropy, and key entropy defines the number of equivalent keys that we get. If we generate our encryption keys from passphrases, and there's only 8,000 passphrases, then we're only using a 13 bits of our encryption key. Okay, so you find there are common passwords. They're often weak, open to social engineering, and so on. And also the password length tends to vary. Users will typically take the smallest password that they can. And obviously, as we've seen, anything up to about 10 really isn't very secure in terms of it being hashed. So we'll quickly go through the basic biometric methods and look at the usability. But it's likely that more and more authentication will happen through biometrics and multi-factor authentication. So the fingerprint scanner on the iPad is perfect, and a PIN number is really all you need to get into many sites. So a lot of the apps I use now, it's a fingerprint to log in, and then maybe a PIN number. And Apple have made sure that the access to the fingerprint scanner is so secure that it's almost impossible for anybody to capture your fingerprint. So all these methods can be open to somebody taking a photocopy of your face and stick it in front of a camera, or if they manage to get your fingerprint off, I don't know if you've seen the demo online, that the chap creates a clay, you touch the desk, he comes along and then lifts your fingerprint off the desk. He then creates a clay model of your finger. He then puts it into the scanner. They're a bit better now in that they will detect heat and so on, but again, you can heat up a finger cast to it. But Apple have know that that's the future of login systems, along with another factor. And more, you'll see out of band. So when I change something on here, then on my other device, a little message will pop up to say, do you know that this new device has been added to your other device? So that they're working together much more. Okay, so fingerprints is obviously one that's used fairly extensively. Just let me get my power supply. But the problem with it is that you need to touch something, which isn't really very good in a healthcare environment. If there are patients touching something to log into a system, then you might be spreading an infection. I have seen a demo of a DNA login system. It is possible to take a bit of your skin or a bit of your hair and get it analysed. I think they've got it down to about 10 minutes now. But if you want to create a really secure environment, then DNA analysis is possible in terms of creating your login system. Just get on it. Increasingly, too, what we're seeing is retina scans and iris scanning. So your eye is fairly unique, not in terms of its colour, but in terms of the little freckles and pits that actually appear on your iris. The problem with it, though, and it hasn't really taken off as much as many people thought it would, was that it just feels a bit uncomfortable to hold a mobile device up to your eye and let it examine your eye. So it hasn't really been used that much, but it's fairly accurate in terms of its identity. The one that is highly accurate is actually the retina scan. So the retina scan will shine some light into your eye and then look at the vein patterns on the back of your eye. The vein patterns are quite distinctive to each of us. In the same way that the vein pattern in your finger is also fairly unique. And I think it was in the Minority Report where the chap has to scan into a network and he gouges out the eye of someone and puts it in front of the scanner and they get in. It doesn't work. So we have talked to clinicians and they have told us that the blood seeps from the veins very quickly. So it isn't really possible. But the retina scan is certainly one method that's fairly accurate. And it can't be spoofed that well, but it could be causing damage to your eye because it's obviously firing some light into it. Facial recognition has moved on a great deal, and it's obviously used in airports and in secure environments. And often, what it does is that it's looking for the width between the length between the eyes, the size of the forehead. And so on. I think I've got some. Just let's see if I can find my little demo here. See my face. Is there that one? See if I can find it. That's that. So this is a basic face scanner. So if we try Theresa May. So this is just a little bit of Python code which detects the eyes and detects the face. So when you take a photograph, you'll see your camera zooms in on a face. So it's looking for that shape. That kind of rectangular type shape. It's more a square face here, but it will generally look for the signs of an eye and the signs of a face here, and we can get it to look for a smile. Hopefully, if it's going to process, just let's try again. We'll try here. That's good. So it can detect a smile, and it's detected the face quite well, but it doesn't quite work. I think Clint Eastwood has an impossible face to detect. It's quite good at detecting his smile there, but I think in terms of his eyes, then he ends up. It's not too bad. It's actually saying there's an eye down here. And there's just a small eye there. But you can even do it with a cat. You can detect a cat. That's going to work, hopefully. Yeah. So I don't know if you can see the blue screen there, but it looks at the cat. And the research work is really, sorry to use David Cameron here, but it's looking for some features of the face and the changes in the colour and generally looking for lines. Okay, so for the eyes, it's looking for the sign of the nose and then the two shapes of the eyes around there. So you don't see that's the code there, and there are XML models for lots of different facial recognition methods. Okay, so it's advanced greatly, and it's used fairly extensively. So one method that's often used now is hand geometry to look at where the lines are in your hand. And the good thing with this is that you don't actually have to touch a scanner. It's possible to hold your hand up in front of it and then for it to view the lines. So voice recognition too has come a long way recently, but it suffers when you have a cold, if you have an accent, and so on. But I've seen demos of systems now that are fairly accurate in determining the user from the voice. Vane is being used quite often now. So the Vane, you put your finger into the device and it will look at the Vane pattern at the back of your finger. Ear shapes is another one. And you can actually even detect someone with a body odor. It doesn't sound a very good method to do it, but you can actually, everybody has a certain scent that's actually given off. And keystroke recognition, you actually find you can accurately determine somebody by the speed that they type it, what they always get wrong, where they always pause, and so on. But there are many ethical issues, and people hate keystroke recognition because they think they're being spied upon. Okay, so that was a quick intro, and hopefully we'll be able to set up some demos of all those different biometric methods for you to see. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go over the basic process now of how certificates fit into this process. Okay, so there's the public key coming over. With the public key, we send the certificate. The certificate has the public key on it. From there, Bob will take his message. He'll then sign with his private key. He then takes Alice's public key and encrypts the whole thing. He then sends that across. She then decrypts with a private key that she takes from her certificate. So she's created a key pair, and she's now using a private key to be able to decrypt. Then we have the hash of the message. Bob then sends over his certificate with his public key, and then the certificate, in this case, has been proven by Trent. If Alice trusts Trent, then she trusts the certificate. Okay, then she's able to look at the signature and check that. Okay, so every time we connect to the internet securely, we should see something like that. So the certificate should give us the confidence that this has actually been, this site is valid. And it's done through the signer. So as long as our system trusts the signer of the certificate, then we can trust the certificate. So certificates are the way that we can get our public key to be sent to the user. So the certificate itself, when we view it, we'll see the basic details of it. It will tell us what the public key is. So in this case, we're using 2048-bit RSA. It gives us our thumbprint, and then it will tell us who issued the certificate. So the issuer is all important in terms of the credibility of the certificate. And you get two certificates. One is the one that you purchase, and you'll see a little key there, and that tells you not to distribute that. So it happened in the Lenovo hack. With the Lenovo hack, the developers released the certificate with both the public and the private key on it, and it took 1 minute for someone to crack the certificate and actually find out the private key, which meant that anybody with a Lenovo, it was possible to crack their HTTPS traffic from them. And it was 1 minute because the developer had used the name of the company who created the DLL as the password for the certificate. So watch, this is the keys to your castle. If you lose this, if you put a weak password on it, then you're not really applying a lot of security. So the certificate that goes out will be this one, and it just has the public key on it. So the key itself is typically you receive an email, and the email looks like that. So you receive it in the body of text, and this is what's called the PB7 format. It's a Base64, and it contains the whole details. You then import that into your system, and then eventually you'll see it with inside your certificate store from them. There are other formats that you can use. There's a binary format that we can apply a password onto it, but this is the most common format that you would receive the certificate. Okay, so that's the basic process that we go through. So how does trust actually happen on the internet? So trust happens because of Trent. And with Trent, what we have is a trusted root. So these are the top level trust authorities on the internet. So VeriSign, Entrust, GoDaddy. And they can actually sign certificates for users. And the operating systems that have been created have their certificates burnt into them. So you can't change the trusted root certificates. They are already on your machine. So the way it works is that Trent will issue Bob a certificate. Bob can then give that to Alice to prove his identity, to prove his public key. And then a trust root certificate is already installed on the machine and will check the validity of the certificate to make sure that certificate has been signed by the trusted root. But unfortunately, what can happen is that Eve pretends to be Bob and then tricks the trusted root into providing a certificate, and the trusted root doesn't check Eve's identity. So you'll find that you can ask for identities. So, I mean, what is my identity? Is it Bill Buchanan or William Buchanan or William J. Buchanan? My son is called the same name as me. So it's very difficult to really prove the identity of a person. And normally they only ask for utility bills and maybe a valid driver's license for the identity. Okay, so the trusted root is the top level, and that should always be trusted. And then we get what's called an intermediate CA. These are certificate authorities who are trusted to sign for certain applications. So someone might be allowed to sign for a VPN, someone for an encrypted file system, and so on. So these intermediate ones are only trusted for certain things. The certificate that should never be trusted is this one here, and that's a self-signed certificate, and it has no credibility at all, because it's just the user saying that I am that user. But you'd be amazed how often users are tricked with this. Another trick that intruders can do is that they'll put a backdoor certificate onto your machines. I've seen many examples of this. When they're installing onto the device, they slip in a trusted root certificate, which means that everything else that they then issue can then be trusted. So they can issue fake certificates from there on. So you should always have a look at your trusted root, just in case someone has slipped in a certificate in there. I think Dell SecureWorks, Dell did it recently. They had a trusted root installed that was self-signed. Okay, and the big problem is that few people really know how to read the certificate and determine if it's trusted or not. So ignoring the date on that, is that a real certificate or not? Is it fake or real?
Real?
VeriSign. So it's got VeriSign Class 3, that looks pretty good, so we'll just have a little look, and it's real. So we go to the top level and we make sure in our browser that it's been signed at the top level and everything's fine. So VeriSign is right. This one here. No. Why? Yeah, self-signed, big. Okay, so it pops up with a little message here. Do you really want to install this? The person thinks that it's okay. If they go and click yes here, then it then installs it as a root certificate. She doesn't have a root in there. And after that, it's actually in their store in there. Global sign. It's acceptable, but it's signing for the whole network. So you've kind of got you've got to worry that it's not really identifying exactly what the device is or what the service is. It's a general system for the whole network. So that's global sign, and that's a real because it does go up to global sign from them. So the last little thing I want to cover, and I touched on it before, is the concept of PGP. So this is PGP here. So I want to go over the core principle of what PGP is all about, just in case it comes up in the test. So PGP uses public key encryption, but uses symmetric encryption for encrypting the email. So if you look at it, we're taking our hash, and then we're encrypting that hash with our private key. So that's the standard way that we would sign for something. We then take the email, we take the signature, and we zip it up. And then we generate a session key, and we take the session key and we encrypt the zip file, and then that gives us our encrypted email. What we then do is that then we take Alice's public key and we encrypt the session key that we're going to use for the email, and we append that onto the encrypted message. Does everybody see what we did there? when it goes to Alice now, Alice how will Alice be able to now read the email? Tell me the steps that she must go through now be able to read the email.
She needs to have her private key first. She needs to have a private key.
Yeah.
And then she needs to have a passphrase to decrypt content using her key.
Not quite. So she doesn't use a private key. Oh. She doesn't read the private key for the email message. Can somebody see how she reads? Not yet. No. What's the first key that Alice will use, and on what will she use it on?
She will need that for encrypting the symmetrical key for decrypting the email, right?
Yeah. What key will she use? Her private key, yeah. So Alice used her public key to be able to encrypt the key, the session key. She'll now use her private key to encrypt the symmetric key that she used. She will then now use that key to do what?
Decrypt
the
message.
Yeah, so she decrypts the message. And then what she reads the message, and then what does she do? That's right. So does everybody get that process of what happens? And the reason that we do this is that public key is just too processor intensive for us to encrypt a message. So we often just encrypt the private. We often just encrypt the session key. So every time we connect to Google, that's typically what's happening. We could encrypt the session key we're going to use with Google's public key. When it goes back, Google will then decrypt that key to give us the session key that we want to use for the communication. Okay, so that's the basics of PGP, and it includes in it certificates, it includes that symmetric encryption, and it also includes public key encryption. Okay, so that's as much as I wanted to do for that. So I'm going to give you an overview of what's going to be in the test and how you should study and so on. Does anybody have any questions on what we've done today or in the last few weeks? Right. So for the test, you should find that the material is outlined here. Okay. So we did four main subjects. I appreciate that we did a lot of things, but we had to do all the things to make sure that we understood where everything actually went. There are other things that were missing just now, like tunnels and disk encryption and so on. I think that's going to be covered in another module, but it's hopefully giving you the foundation to be able to build on, because cryptography and encryption is going to become one of the most important subjects in security, with things like GDPR coming along. And you can't just say, yes, we're using encryption. You've got to understand all the methods that are actually used. So those are the four areas. And you should find that there's a material and what you should learn on in each one. So for our public key, there should be a what you've learnt, and then there's a tutorial down below. So there are lots of questions. They're just giving you the hint of what the questions are going to look like. There are more critical, more open-ended. Please attempt them. Say something and you'll hopefully get some marks for it. If you don't say anything, you get 0 marks. So even if you don't understand quite what the answer is looking towards, just do some critique. So you find the questions are aimed more at critical type thinking. You might come across a new problem that you've not came across before, and you must reason through it. Okay, so if you're unsure of any of the questions, then please ask and try to get into the mode of thinking about how you answer this type of question. First thing you look at is the amount of marks that you're getting. If you're getting 1 or 2 marks, for something, then it's not going to require a wrong answer. If you're getting 10 marks, then it probably does require a bit more thought. Make sure you've went through all the questions and understand all the marks that are involved, because the last thing you want is to hit a question at the very end and you find that's worth a lot of marks and you didn't have time to do that one. So try and balance your time when you're answering the questions. Okay, so there's a bit on that you can actually do, and then there's a couple of mock exams. So I'll update these. So try and do a little mock exam and get yourself timed and go through the test. Take your time, because once you've been through the mock exam, you probably can go through it quickly again. So make sure that you actually know how long it's going to take you if you come across new questions. The answer should be down below there. And then we'll set up a little basic study guide for you. Then you need to go through each of these areas and try and understand what the questions are hinting towards. Okay, and that's it. Does anybody have any questions about the test?
What about aliases segment
for the IDS? Yeah. I'll have to I'll check with you on that, but you'll get a full study guide that'll include any questions that are included from IDS. But I think it's probably just going to focus on crypto, but we'll
IDS was going to be the coursework.
Is the coursework, yeah. That's more
the
coursework.
The first class is
in. Yeah. And it allows you to focus. You'll get feedback and you'll know where you are. If you've not done so well, then we'll give feedback about how you can do better. If you've done too well, then we'll tell you to. I don't know, we'll give you a PhD or something like that. We'll offer you a PhD, sorry, I should have said. So Benny, any other?
Wait, is the first?
Mm. I need to check that. I'll email you. And if you've got any questions, then please just ask. We're after a different type of answer at MSc that you might not have been used to, and the type of questions aren't quite as guided as you've maybe seen from undergraduate studies. Any other one? I want to do one last thing that isn't examined, but it's likely to be the future, and I'd like to do is won't be examined, but this is generally the way that our systems are moving. Just let me try and get on that. So if you don't have to, then don't run an identity service on your network. So increasingly what's happening is that you can create a service infrastructure where you can bind services together. So if you need an authentication infrastructure, you can go to Microsoft or you can go to Google and you can federate your IDs. Does anybody know the two main frameworks that are used within inside a trusted identity infrastructure? One begins with O. It's OAuth. Yeah. So OAuth is a way to create what's called federated identity. And federated identity is all about actually divorcing the service from the identity, or to have a service provider and an identity provider. So there should be no communication between the identity provider and the service provider. So if I want to log in to, say, the NHS, and the NHS trusts Google as an identity provider, I go through Google, I prove my identity to Google, NHS trusts Google, I get a token that proves my identity for a certain amount of time. I then pass that to the service provider and that will work. So there's no communication really required between here and here. And increasingly that's what's happening on the internet, where we can actually trust identity providers to prove our identity without actually logging into the service that's been hosted. So this is Open ID, which is used by a lot of companies just now, and it can create a federated identity infrastructure. And it's a bit like this type of model, where if we go to the to an airport, we check in, we prove our identity, and then we get a ticket or a token that we can then provide to each of what's called the reliant party. And then there's a trust network that's created between our identity provider and our reliant party, which is our airline security there. We can then extend it, so we can distribute it, so there can be many places that we can actually check in and prove identities, but each of them are actually trusted by our reliant party. And this is generally the way that applications are going in terms of a trust infrastructure. You go and ask for your service. You want to log into to PayPal or your bank or something like that. Your bank will then tell you what identity providers it trusts. You then go to one of those identity providers. You prove your identity to them. They give you a token. The token will be valid for a certain amount of time. You give the token to a reliant party, and then it agrees. It proves your identity. Can anybody see a flaw in this type of infrastructure? So it works well because there's no communication between the identity provider and the reliant party. So that's good. But can you see a flaw in here? So fundamentally, that's the problem with OAuth. If you lose your token or somebody gets it from you, they can then go around and use your identity. So if you're using this type of model, you limit the amount of time the token is valid for to stop that from happening. So that's the core problem with OAuth. The banks don't use this. So the banks don't use this. Does anybody know what they use? I'm not expecting you to know this one. they use a method called SAML. So SAML is a proper security federated infrastructure to implement. It's very costly to actually do it. This is a cheap, OAuth is a very cheap approach to do it from them. And more we're logging in through Facebook and Twitter or Windows Live when we're logging in. But again, we go back to the point that that's just one way. In your systems that you design, you should have another factor. So you could prove your identity to Google or Facebook, but you really want to be proving with the fingerprint too. Okay, so that was the last little bit that we're going to do. And I look forward to seeing the lab work today. And that's the last little bit of this bit of the module. Thank you.